Light of the seraphim of God, cherubim of light and covering angels, seven mighty archangels of God. O our Father, Mother God, hear our call in this hour. Send legions of angels to succor the youth of the world. Cut them free, Archangel Michael, by your sword of blue flame. Deliver the children unto God and cut them free from all burdens that are upon them, burdens of non-fulfillment of their reason for being, of drugs, of darkness descending. Almighty God, deliver our children. Deliver the souls aborted. Deliver all life. We pray in this hour for divine intercession. We call to the Immaculate Heart of Mary, the Sacred Heart of Jesus. We call for the light within us to expand and to go forth as we pray to assist all life to find that inner connection through Jesus Christ our Lord. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and the Divine Mother. Amen. How to contact angels, your guides, guardians, and friends. Why should we contact angels? Simply because they are our guides, guardians, and friends, and simply because God created angels to help us, to minister unto us, and to do many wonderful things for us. I was interested to read the story in the March 1992 issue of Life magazine, which told of how angels brought comfort to one family. Dr. Diane Comp, an oncologist and professor of pediatrics from Yale University, sat with a family at the bedside of their 7-year-old daughter. She was dying of leukemia. In her final moments, she suddenly sat up, summoned with strength, and said, "Mommy, can you see them? Do you hear their singing? I've never heard such beautiful singing." Whereupon the child laid down and breathed her last breath. Dr. Comp said that the only thing that she could describe as to what she felt was summed up in the word gift. The angels had given a gift to the parents, bringing comfort to them that there was something more than they could see, and that their daughter was in good hands. And so they could truly understand the grieving and then the letting go of her passing. They could never forget that the angels were waiting to receive their daughter in heaven. But would they know that those same angels would be preparing her soul to return to earth sometime in a future embodiment? The word angel comes from the Latin angelus, meaning messenger. Angels are God's messengers sent to us. They are divine spirits. They are heralds of the Son of God. And they go before him to proclaim his day. So who are the angels? Who are you? Who am I? The author of Hebrews tells us a mystery, which I would like to unveil this evening. No one is quite sure who wrote the book of Hebrews. I have even wondered if our Lord wrote it himself, because it is so mystical and so profound, and it tells us things about Jesus that no other scripture tells us. And so the book begins with these words: God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers and the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the world, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. The author of Hebrews is explaining to us the hierarchy of heaven, of the angels, of the Son of God, and of the sons and daughters of God. We are beginning to understand what our lawful place is in relationship to God, his Son, and his angels. For unto which of the angels said he at any time, Thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee? And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. And again, when he bringeth in the first begotten into the world, he saith, And let all the angels of God worship him. Now we know that the angels of God worship the living Christ, the Son of God. And of the angels God said, Who maketh his angels spirits, and his ministers a flame of fire? So angels are spirits of God. They are ministers who minister unto us. They are ministering servants. But they are made of a flame of fire. So now we know that the nature of angels is something different from our own nature. They are made of the fire of God itself. But unto the Son he saith, Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Therefore God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. And thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth and the heavens and the works of thine hands. They shall perish, but thou remainest. And they shall all wax old as doth a garment, and as a vesture shalt thou fold them up, and they shall be changed. But thou art the same, and thy years shall not fail. But to which of the angels said he at any time, Sit on my right hand, until I make thine enemies thy footstool? Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation? We then are the heirs of the salvation of Jesus Christ, and we know that God has sent his emissaries, his ministering servants, his angels, to assist us in the very day-to-day process of our salvation. So now we know why we should get to know angels, why we should interact with them. Because God has ordained them unto the glorification of his Son in our body and in our members. I would like to speak to you about the Son of God and the living Christ, and so I would show you the chart of the presence. This is the basic teaching that our beloved Jesus Christ and beloved Saint Germain have given to us. The chart of the presence is a picture of you. When we ask the question, who am I? The chart answers that question. I am a child of God. I am a son or a daughter of God. I am shown as I am now as the lowest figure in the chart. The individual who is invoking the Holy Spirit. And God responds and sends that Holy Spirit as the gift of the violet flame. And so you can see yourself in this chart as that lower figure, praising God for his angels, praising God for his Holy Spirit, and celebrating this greatest of gifts, the violet forgiveness flame, the violet transmuting flame. Where does the Son of God appear in the chart? The Son of God is the middle figure. The middle figure in the chart is the only begotten Son of God, who is the universal Christ. That universal Christ was fully embodied in the incarnate Word, our Lord Jesus Christ. Yet he came to show us a path, and he left footprints in the sands that we might follow. The great division between the schools of Gnosticism of the early church and the Roman and Eastern Orthodox churches falls upon whether we worship Jesus as the only flesh and blood God and Son of God, or we discover that the word Christ is from the Greek Christos, meaning anointed with light, and that same light wherewith God has anointed us, he has also anointed Jesus. The same light of that Christ in Jesus is now a potential, a divine spark, a threefold flame within us. As we look at the whole chart now, we see that Christ is the mediator between the lower self that is fallen into a state of karma, which the world would call a state of sin. The upper figure in the chart represents the I am that I am who appeared to Moses, the mighty angel of the Lord who declared him, I am that I am. This is my name forever and my memorial to all generations. I am that I am is a statement of being. It is a statement of God's presence with us. That presence of God never leaves us, though we ourselves may leave that presence by being out of harmony, out of alignment with that presence and the laws of God. Habakkuk speaks of the presence when he said, mine eyes are too pure to behold iniquity. Because God is perfection and the absolute, and the I am that I am is the first manifestation of what the Kabbalah calls Ein Sof, the unmanifest God. So we see the manifest God is that perfection. We are imperfect, and so we do not have that opportunity to see God face to face. Who sees God face to face is the Son of God, the living Christ. So God, who maketh his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire, created angels before he created us. Why? So that when he created us, we would have caretakers. We would have someone to care for us. He fashioned angels out of his own flaming presence, his own flaming spirit. Therefore, when we consider angels and we consider our presence, we can understand that that Holy Christ presence has many times been called the guardian angel. People think of the guardian angel as just another angel, but the true guardian presence of our life is Christ the Lord, personified in the one whom we address as the Holy Christ self. We are liberated then from the sense that we will forevermore be sinners, cast in a mold of flesh and original sin, that we can truly rise to that stature of the fullness of Christ because God ordained it, and not only did he ordain it, but he sent us angels to preach to us, to heal us, to care for us, to enlighten us, to move us to the understanding that God would never send us forth into these lower levels of our karma without himself going along. God came along with us to this world in the person of that Holy Christ self, in the person of the I Am presence. Understanding this, we move forward on the foundation as to why it is so important that we not only enlist the help of angels, but that we exercise the authority of the Son of God that is within us. And in the name of the I am that I am, we command these legions of angels to go forth, to stop war, to rescue life, to find and give us the cure for AIDS, to deal and tackle with all problems in our society, in our schools, in our families, in our homes, in ourselves, in our own psychology. We can call upon angels to do anything. And if we call with love and according to the will of God and his laws, they will never ever fail to answer us. The booklet you have on angels contains prayers, decrees, songs, fiats to the angels, and we're going to be using them throughout this class. So now I will get on with my message to you about angels. Angels are flames of living fire, sacred fire. Sacred fire of God is not hot, it is cool, except when it touches discord or misqualified energy. When you come into the aura of an angel or he comes into your aura, he will not leave you as he has found you. And so by his very living, flaming presence, you may feel the alchemy of transmutation, of the consuming of old stubbornness and pride. It is a humbling experience, profoundly humbling. Angels are extensions of God's presence, and they manifest in a form that we can recognize. They are ministering servants. They tend our spirits, our minds, our souls, our bodies. They are sent by God as messengers to deliver his word. They have a multitude of functions. They protect us, they guide us, strengthen us, heal us, comfort us, teach us, counsel us, and they warn us. I perceive that angels are angles of God's consciousness. God is infinite. We cannot know him in mortal consciousness. But angels can reveal various sides of God's nature, angles of God that we would not perceive on our own. They are like our second sight. They are like looking through the all-seeing eye of God at God himself, without God quite knowing that we are watching him. They come in at every point and angle and vector of the universe to deliver their light to our bodies. They give us a literal transfusion to our organs, to every part of us. But the key is we must welcome them. We must call upon them. This is the contract, or if you will, the covenant that God, our Father, Mother, made with us when we left out of that glorious presence and gradually descended into the veils of illusion, of imperfection, and of forgetfulness of his laws, and therefore disobedience to his laws. God said to us very lovingly, "You have gone out of our presence. You have chosen to be in lesser octaves, lower vibrations. You have chosen to have your own way and to do things your way. You have chosen to exercise the gift I have given to you of free will. But you have chosen not to exercise it, to always choose the will of God, but rather to manifest your own willfulness. So here is what we're going to do. We, your Father, Mother, are going to give you this vast matter universe for exploration, discovery, and specifically, we're assigning you to planet Earth. And you can do anything you want to do. Of course, there is the law of karma. As a man soweth, that shall he also reap. You can learn the consequences of your actions that are not in keeping with our laws. We will not interfere. We will not interfere with anything at all. We give you totally free rein. The records of cataclysms, of wars of the gods on the ancient continent of Lemuria or Atlantis, past ages that have no records whatsoever in our history books, attest to the fact that God has been true to his word. He has not interceded when a little child is perhaps burned in a fire. He has not interceded when 6 million Jews were burned in concentration camps, and these were God's chosen people. He has left Catholic, Protestant, Muslim, Hindu alike to their own devices and to their subsequent karma. But he has said, if you call to me, if you call upon the Lord, if you praise my name, if you ask me to send intercessors in the persons of my angels, I will send them immediately to your side. And according to your karma, according to your situation, you may have complete and ultimate divine intercession or some sort of aid. This is the law and the covenant that God has made with us.
So many people in the world are frustrated and sometimes angry. You see the symbol of the clenched fist, which is the symbol of the defiance of Almighty God and His laws. And people are angry with God because He has allowed their child to die, or this to happen to them. They have said, this is not our earthquake, this is God's earthquake. This is not our hurricane, this is God's hurricane. But in fact, every erg of energy that we have all sent out, billions of us on planet Earth, that is negative, that is hateful, wrathful, angry, accumulates and multiplies and returns to us in weather conditions, in calamities, in sudden, tremendous challenges that come upon us in our personal lives, our businesses, in our nations, and in the earth. So the reason why there is a delayed reaction of God answering us through His angels is that we have put so many walls of barriers of our karma, of our negative consciousness, of our defiance of God between us and Him, that now we have to carve a hole through this very dense wall of protection we have built to protect our human ego and our right to be who we are as somebody important apart from God. By and by, some of us, hopefully most of us, get very tired of this merry-go-round of being our own person and falling on our noses and on our faces, embodiment after embodiment. And we are humbled by God and His presence, by our love for His Son. And we say, I want no more of this. I want to live my life according to the will of God. I want to serve Him. I want to help others find Him. And I'm no longer going to use my free will except in confirmation of God's will. When we decide to turn around and face the Son of God and the Son of our I Am presence and walk that homeward path, we will have to pick up every step of the way, every step we take, our karma, our mistakes, our unkind words, our arguments, all of those things that are not of God. And we must balance that karma. We do so by invoking the violet flame and by service to life. And the grace of the Son of God is that this process can be accelerated. And so we do not believe that it will take us millions of years and manvantaras to get back to God, but that in fact, by diligence and service, this process can happen in this lifetime or a couple of lifetimes. But we need to take the teachings of Jesus Christ and Saint Germain and apply them, because there are things we definitely need to do if we expect to stand in the presence of the Son of God and claim that Son as our real self and be drawn as He was in the Ascension to the heart of the I Am that I am. And so angels are here to help us find our way back home if that's where we want to go. And if we tell them we want to serve God on earth for many lifetimes, they will be with us on earth for many lifetimes and help us in whatever our calling from God is. Angels have enormous auras of light. And what they do best is to intensify the feelings of God in our beings, feelings of love and faith and hope, of honor and courage and mercy. Every virtue that you can think of that is ennobling, that assists others, that brings us closer to God. Angels will come into your aura when you are in a moment of greatest tragedy and bring comfort and a sense that all is well, even though you are devastated. We are so often supported by angels that we almost take them for granted and do not realize how much worse life could be on earth without their loving presence. Angels sometimes take on human form, and then they move among us as our truest friends and helpers. The ancient myth of the fall of angels is actually true. And when therefore the good angels, who cast them out of heaven under Archangel Michael, saw that these fallen angels in the earth went about to make war against the children of God, the good angels said, "We will volunteer. We want to go down and take physical embodiment and be born through human mothers so that we can personally walk and talk with people and warn them of the evils of fallen angels who rise to power in the money markets of the world, in the economy, in the governments of the nations, and make a mess of them, and take the people's light and take the people's money, and torment the people with things like drugs and liquor, nicotine, all of the vices that come upon people to take them away from God. We want to go out and preach the word and proclaim the message of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, whom we worship. And so you will find that even your best friend or your greatest confidant or someone close to you was once an angel and began to embody on earth and now has continued to embody in the evolution of the sons and daughters of God. As you know, the Apostle Paul was inspired by angels to say to the rest of the disciples and to the people, "Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares." We're not always aware that someone who is lending a helping hand is an angel in disguise. Archangels are the captains or hierarchs of the angelic hosts. They preside over what are called the seven rays. You can see the seven rays in the seven rings of the great causal body that surrounds the I Am Presence. Those are actually spheres of light. Your I Am Presence and causal body as one is a replica of the spheres of light that surround the spiritual physical center of our spirit matter cosmos that we cannot even see. It is called the Great Central Sun. And so these spheres of color bands are worlds within worlds. You were created in the beginning in the image of the Father, Mother, God, male and female, as twin flames. So you are one half of a divine whole, and your other half may be sitting next to you or across on the other side of the earth or across the solar systems. Because of our willfulness and making much karma, we have often separated from our twin flames for thousands of years, which is why we understand and how we understand a certain inner loneliness, a certain sense that we are not with the one that we love most, that is the other half of ourself. That we have lost that one somewhere and we must find that one. The poem of Angeline is a story of the search for the twin flame. Twin flames then go forth as individual people, sometimes one is the male, sometimes the other, going forth through all of these spheres of light and finally descending to a level of embodiment, physical embodiment. And so in earlier golden ages, people never descended as low as we are today. They remained in octaves of light and perfection. They didn't buy the forbidden fruit of fallen angels or of evil. They resisted the temptations that our forebears and we did not resist. And therefore, they remained in levels of perfection and ascended back to God without ever having made negative karma. These races are called root races. And they are certain bands of souls, perhaps millions, many millions of souls, who go out from the central sun in light epochs. And this has been going on as the ages have gone forth and as they have returned again to the central sun. So these seven rays denote seven planes of consciousness. And the seven archangels occupy, each one of them with their divine complement, one of those seven rays. The divine complement of an archangel is known as an archia, and the plural is archai. Archangels, as I have said, are emanations of God. They are the direct extensions of God. They embody the fullness of the presence of God. When we understand that, we can understand the mystery of Exodus, which explains that Moses looked and he saw in the bush that burned but was not consumed, an angel of the Lord. And then pretty soon, as it goes on, it is the Lord himself who is speaking to Moses. How did the angel of the Lord become the Lord? I am that I am. It is because an archangel has the stature of being the full presence and embodiment of the living God, of the Almighty One, who is manifest to you in that I am presence. If you visualize the one God as the great central sun, a blazing presence of light, as you understand the unmanifest and manifest God, and you see the rays coming forth from the sun, even as you see these rays on the chart, you can see angels as the ray of light. And you can see that a ray of light actually contains all the fullness of God, even as the proverbial drop in the ocean contains all the elements of the sea. So when you stand in the presence of an archangel, you stand in the presence of God. It is awesome. Archangels are architects. They plan and design what is happening in the entire cosmos, age after age. God uses them to draft the plans for his projects and to execute those plans along with the nature spirits and the manifestation of God as Elohim. Archangels arc God's light to man, to our very heart. They quicken our hearts to convey the divine blueprint. When you know who you are and what you're going to do in life and your course of study, your mission, your profession, your calling, how did you know it? Did you think it up? Well, you might have thought you thunk it up, but in fact, an angel may have arced that light from your I am presence because you are not in exactly the fullest attunement with that I am presence, and arced that awareness, that inner knowingness, that sense. This is what I have to do in this life. This experience actually happened to me. I was 18 years old, and I was standing on the steps of the Christian Science Church in Red Bank, New Jersey, my hometown. I had just come out of church, and I was filled with the light of my meditation upon God. Church to me all of my life was that experience. I couldn't tell what anybody else was doing in their pews, but whenever I got into any church, it really didn't matter which one. I was so filled with the light of God, I was simply transported somewhere else. And so I came out of church and I looked at the end of the large step that came out from the front door. It was like a large platform. And I saw this light by a pillar. And as I looked, I realized this was the Archangel Gabriel. And I saw him and I was absolutely astounded. And yet not astounded, because he surrounded me with his aura and made me feel that it was altogether natural to be seeing an archangel. And so I stood there and I felt the power of his mind. And I felt him transmit a message to my mind. And this transmission was so powerful in broad daylight with all the people pouring out of church. I exclaimed out loud in response to the impacting of my mind that I felt. I said, why, I have to make my ascension in this life. And then I stood back and I said, what did I just say? No one had ever taught me that anyone else besides Jesus Christ was supposed to make their ascension, to ascend. It was never discussed. Not in the Orthodox churches I'd been to, and not in the metaphysical movement that I was into in Christian Science. No one ever said that the ascension was the goal of life, and that there was a course of study and footsteps you had to take and things you had to do and debts you had to balance, and it just didn't happen automatically, as my Christian Science teacher told me many years later, well, you don't have to worry about your ascension. It just happens automatically. Nothing happens automatically, and definitely not the most important event of your entire existence on planet Earth, the moment of your soul's ultimate and final reunion with God. The ascension is the goal of your life. And as a matter of fact, it is the Archangel Gabriel who comes to you, whether you are conscious of it or not. comes to your soul and announces to you, this is the lifetime when you can make it. This is the lifetime when, if you do all things well, that door will swing wide and you will attain union with God to go out no more. You will no longer have to return, reincarnating lifetime after lifetime to clean up what you did in the last lifetime and 10 and 20, 30 embodiments ago. How many of you have had that intimation from God that this is the lifetime when you should make your ascension? Look at all of you in this room. This is a marvelous show of hands. It's an attestation to the figure of Archangel Gabriel in your life, and you should cherish and treasure that and get a picture of Archangel Gabriel, one of the old master's paintings, and keep it somewhere where you say, hi, Gabriel, every day. Thanks for letting me know. Thanks for telling me. Now I know where I'm going and why I need to be doing what I'm doing, even if it's all not always the most pleasant task that I could choose. The archangels help us to balance our karma on each of the seven rays. We make karma specifically on those rays and through the misuse of our chakras. So now I'd like to show you the lower figure in the chart, you, as the chakra man, or the chakra woman, or the chakra child. Will the real chakra man please stand up? That's all right, you can be seated. Okay, those chakras show the seven rays. And those seven rays correlate to those same color spheres, the same colors that are in your causal body. Each of the archangels assists you in amplifying the light of God in one of those chakras. The archangels send their angels to assist you to balance your misuse of the light of God in one of those chakras. A chakra is a spiritual center. Its purpose is so that God, your I Am Presence, can step down the light to a certain frequency. Each one of the seven rays, from the base to the crown, has a different frequency. So as the light of God is stepped down through the chakras, you experience God in a different way in each plane of your being. For instance, you think through the crown chakra, you see through the third eye, you exercise the power of the spoken word through the throat chakra. You experience love in the heart, desire in the solar plexus, the presence of the soul and intuition in the seat of the soul chakra, and the white fire of the Divine Mother in the base chakra, which is the fount of light that rises and is the power of procreation. Archangel Zadkiel teaches us how to balance karma with a violet flame. And that's a very important part of the work we do in this activity. Well, of course, my encounter with Archangel Gabriel, and I'm certain yours also, whether it was conscious or just as an inner knowing, sent me and you on a relentless course. We have determined that we want to know God face to face. The scriptures say that no man can see God's face and live. Who would want to see God's face? Well, Mark Prophet gave me the understanding of that scripture, and he said, what it really means and what it really says is, no man can see God and live as man any longer. Because once he has seen God, he will have the imprint of God in his being and in his mind and in his heart. And henceforth, he must live as the God manifestation, or the manifestation of God. So you are not going to drop dead if you see the face of your I Am Presence or your Holy Christ Self. But one glimpse of that presence in prayer, in communion with God, and the whole universe changes for you. You have discovered who you are, because that God presence is, in truth, your reality. This wasn't the first time I had experienced angels. I remember water skiing on the Navisink River in Red Bank. And I was on those skis for the longest time, going toward the sea, under the bridges. It was a beautiful day. And somewhere along the way, I transcended my physical consciousness. And I looked up into the heavens, and I simply saw the glory of God. I was aware not of thousands, but millions of presences, of angels and of souls, and they were rejoicing. They were rejoicing that my time had come and their time had come, and we were entering in an age when all of us, as a band of wherever we came from, were going to be able to make it in this life. It was so thrilling. I was in the midst of dealing with my karma and all kinds of things that teenagers go through. But my days were always filled with attention on God. And that was a moment that I will never forget. I had many other such moments when I was aware of the throngs of heaven, the souls of light who were attending, and then the angels too. It was not just angels, it was souls who were preparing to come into embodiment, who had just left embodiment, but they were all rejoicing. My search for God led me to Mark Prophet in 1961 when I was a student in political science at Boston University. I attended a meeting where he spoke, he delivered a lecture, and then he delivered a dictation from Saint Michael the Archangel. I was thrilled beyond words to hear that dictation and also to experience in meditation before it took place, as Mark Prophet was able to lift my soul to another dimension, and I saw the whole earth and all of the children of the light and the people that I needed to contact. They looked like daisies in the field, millions of daisies, and each one had a face of a soul, someone I must go and find, someone I must give what? A teaching I did not yet know, a teaching I would receive. It was a brief interlude before the meditation music began for the dictation, and I was in rapt attention. It was the first time in my life I had ever heard an archangel or an angel speak through a human being. It was a powerful message, an address to the people of Boston, that if you pray to Archangel Michael, he will take you to octaves of light at the end of your embodiment. He also said, "People of Boston, I am come to cut you free." And I knew he was talking to me. I was about to be cut free for my mission. I was trained by the Ascended Master El Moria to be a messenger for the angels, for the saints of God. And I was trained through Mark Prophet in Washington. We were married. We had four children, and he passed on as he said he would. He prophesied his own passing. He stayed with me a little bit longer than he said he would. It was 12 years. During those years and the years which followed, the two of us have taken hundreds of dictations from archangels and angels of God. All of these are in our files, and many of them are published. I'm going to quote from some of these dictations, some of the very special messages that the angels have given us for all of you. I'd like to show you Saint Michael the Archangel, probably one of the angels most familiar to you. He serves on the first ray, the ray of God's holy will and of power. It's a ray of perfection, protection, faith, and God's government in the earth. God's power is available to you only when you prove to God over and over and over again that you will not misuse his power. We misuse power through wrong speech patterns, the way in which we put people down or express anger or our pride. There are many ways that we misuse power. Again, the first ray and the throat chakra is the power center. It has 16 petals, and Archangel Michael's divine complement is the Archia Faith. Michael's day is Tuesday. That means that you have the greatest access to him on Tuesday. He works through the seventh band of the causal body. If you look back to the causal body, we will see that the outer ring is blue. The blue band seals and protects the entire causal body. All of the archangels maintain etheric retreats, which means a retreat in the plains of heaven where their angels congregate. And so Archangel Michael's retreat is approximately at Banff near Lake Louise in Alberta, Canada. That is the physical location that corresponds to the place in the heaven world where this retreat is. It's a beautiful focus for meditation. The etheric octave is the octave of perfection. That's why we call it heaven. Heaven is not such a simple place. There are actually 33 definable levels of heaven, each one exceeding the previous one in the intensity of light and the manifestation of perfection. You might say that the first level of heaven is kindergarten, where good souls go who haven't made so much karma, but who are not really that adept in their pursuit of the path. Often these good souls are good religious people who have not strayed outside of the narrow bands of their own orthodox traditions. So there are schools of light, universities of the spirit. You may have a remembrance of having attended school at night under teachers of light. It was not a dream, it was a reality. These schools are going on all over the earth at various locations. And so the astral plane, which some people call purgatory or death and hell, has 33 levels also, and they are in a descending order of intensification of darkness and a descending order of the types of people that you find there. And so when you get all the way to the bottom of the astral plane at the 33rd level, you are at the place that is called hell, and it is very dark, and the most vicious of fallen angels are there. The first three or four or six levels of the astral plane might resemble certain areas of the world that we are in the physical plane. Places that are inharmonious, that are dark, that are tied to materialism or sensuality, or the various addictions that people get into. And so people who have put themselves in those lower vibrations while in embodiment go to the same vibration when out of embodiment, and really the only difference is that they are without a physical body. And so what the ascended masters are attempting to do with their students today, and the angels as well, is to see to it that all of you who are students on the path will arrive somewhere in the etheric octave at the conclusion of this embodiment. To make sure that you do, it is important that you use the heart, head, and hand decrees daily that are in the booklet I've given you, and that you invoke the violet flame. The violet flame is the key to transmutation, and it will help you balance karma that you may have with people who themselves are not servants of light, but are servants of darkness, servants of corruption. These people that you may have karma with because you've become angry with them, or you've gotten into some kind of dealings with them, or you've broken the law, or you have been convinced by such people who have so provoked you to lose your cool, to become upset, or to do some kind of physical or bodily harm to such people. When you get entangled with people who are of a low energy, who have no light in them and are not servants of the light, those are the people that you want to balance your karma with. It's very important. And they can be in your own household, they can be in your own families, or they can be people you hardly know. The goal that you should have in this life, among other very serious goals, is to settle your accounts, your karma, with people of that sort. Because if you don't, the tie you have to them can pull you down to the level that they go to when they pass on from the screen of life. And once you get caught in those lower octaves, and you really do get caught by these entangling alliances and relationships that you have, it is not easy to get out of the astral plane. And when you get lower and lower into the astral plane, you need an archangel to rescue you. At that point, you need someone on earth who is in embodiment, who's going to make a call. Archangel Michael, descend to the depths of the astral plane, this light, and rescue all light bearers who are caught there against their will and against their wishes. There are many people who are caught at lower levels who are good people. They just happen to fall into trouble. That's why the tradition in many of the world's religions is to have a wake, to pray for people, pray for their souls when they pass on. And that's not only in Catholicism, it's in other Eastern religions. Because not only do we understand that people can be drawn to those levels, but that there are evil spirits who move about on the astral plane seeking to trap souls who have newly passed from embodiment. So assisting people in the hour of their passing is the work of the angels, and we make it our work also. So I advise you that no matter what it takes, that you make sure that you give and give with your cup running over to those to whom you have a debt, rather than be quarreling about that debt, because a quarrel in itself is tying you and locking you into a relationship that you do not want to be tied to. So that's just a little side teaching I'm giving you, because I'm talking to you about the various octaves. So the octaves of perfection, the highest etheric octaves, are where the Christed ones, the Buddhas, the Bodhisattvas are, the great adepts, all the way up to the 33rd heaven. So it's interesting to understand the shades and the gradations of life. So the mountain that you see here is the point of going forth and return to a tremendous etheric retreat in the highest octaves of the heaven world, where the angels maintain their focus, their station on planet Earth. So Archangel Michael is the angel of the Lord that comes to protect us, to preserve our freedom in the earth, and to deliver the righteous judgments of God upon the seed of the wicked one, the seed of Lucifer. So Archangel Michael is the prince of the archangels, and his title is Captain of the Lord's Hosts. Archangel Michael has said, there are days when for one single one of you, I and my legions, in order to defend you, will slay 10,000 demons. What kinds of demons would be attacking us? There are demons for everything. There are demons of pride who goad you to have greater pride. There are demons of jealousy that feed that seed of jealousy. There are demons of the nicotine habit that enslave you to the addiction of cigarette smoking and tobacco. Anything that is not constructive will have lesser demons going along, trying to convince you through well-meaning so-called friends that you should be a part of this or that activity. So there are discarnates attached to the earth, that is, evil spirits without bodies, and they move about. They color the aura of a place. You go somewhere, you don't like the way it feels, you leave. You sense the vibration of a place, and you choose where you decide to spend time according to that vibration. People tend to congregate in the same place and the same vibrations that they have according to the demons or the entities of the discarnates that are around them. The Goddess of Liberty tells us that Archangel Michael is at your side and does answer your call, and does answer it best when you keep a daily momentum. You can call for a coil of blue fire around you from beneath your feet above. This blue coil is a shield and an armor. It's a flaming blue coil that you visualize and that you call as a part of your prayers. When Jesus spoke with authority, he spoke with the authority of God, and he commanded the angels, and the angels were a part of his healings. When you speak in the name of God, you also should speak in the authority of the Christ within you. I would like to show you how to give an immediate call to Archangel Michael, if you'll take out the angel booklet. This is on the first page, number 2. It's called the Throat Chakra Meditation. It's for the sealing of that powerful energy that you have at the throat. It's the affirmation of your I Am Presence as Master. This is the decree that acknowledges God as the only one to whom you give allegiance, your only Master. You are disclaiming that you acknowledge your ego or your lesser self as the master of your life, or that anything has the power to cause you to have an addiction of any kind. If God is master, then he is master of your life. You need only accept it in faith. The angel that brings to you the quality of faith and the presence of faith is Archangel Michael and his divine consort, the Archie of Faith. So let us simply affirm this with all of our hearts and love as we talk to God and give it as a decree. Together. I am presence, thou art master. I am presence, clear the way. Let thy light and all thy power take possession here this hour. Charged with ICP's mastery, blaze blue lightning, blaze thy substance into this thy form descent. That perfection and its glory shall blaze forth and earth transcend. I am presence, thou art master, I am presence, clear the way. Let thy light and all thy power take possession here this hour. Charge the victory's mastery, blaze with lightning, blaze thy substance into this thy form descend. That perfection and its glory shall blaze forth and earth transcend. I am presence, thou art master, I am presence, clear the way. Let thy light and all thy power take possession here this hour. Charge with victory's mastery, blaze with lightning, blaze thy substance into this thy form descent. That perfection and its glory shall blaze forth and move transcend. I am presence, thou art master, I am presence, clear the way. Let thy light and all thy power take possession here this hour. Charge with victory's mastery, blaze with lightning, blaze thy substance into this thy form descent. That perfection and its glory shall blaze forth and earth transcend. The traveling protection, number 4 in the second column at the bottom. This is a call you give whenever you get in your car, whenever you are traveling, anywhere you are. You take one of the pictures we have of Archangel Michael. We'll put up one of them now. Pick your favorite one, memorize it, and see it. See it standing. See Archangel Michael standing before you as the decree says. Before me, behind me, to my right, to my left, above and below, and in the center of my form. You see Archangel Michael in position around your vehicle, or bus, or train, or plane. You call for protection. And then you maximize the call. You never finish a prayer without saying, this which I call forth for myself, I call forth for all the children of God and the sons and daughters of God upon earth. And instantaneously, that same presence of Archangel Michael is upon them. You can call for all children of God throughout the entire matter cosmos to have this action of Archangel Michael, and it will be done. The quality of faith is not blind. The quality of faith means that you know the law of God and his promise to you. If you will serve my will, I will send my angels to intercede for you and give you the protection you need to make it. That is the law of God. That it is his word. That is his promise. Do not fear, do not doubt, but have faith. Because God always keeps his promises to you, even if you do not see the direct answer to your prayer. It will come. It will surely come. It will manifest in some way. Let's give this then in the authority of God. By the authority of my mighty I Am Presence, by the authority of the Christ within me, I summon you, Archangel Michael, for the protection, the absolute physical, spiritual, mental, emotional, psychological protection of all who are of God on this planet and all systems of world. Therefore, in God's name, I say, Lord Michael before, Lord Michael behind, Lord Michael to the right, Lord Michael to the left, Lord Michael above, Lord Michael below, Lord Michael wherever I go. I am his love protecting here, I am his love protecting here, I am his love protecting here. Lord Michael before, Lord Michael behind, Lord Michael to the right, Lord Michael to the left, Lord Michael above, Lord Michael below, Lord Michael wherever I go. I am his love protecting here, I am his love protecting here, I am his love protecting here. Lord Michael before, Lord Michael behind, Lord Michael to the right, Lord Michael to the left, Lord Michael above, Lord Michael below, Lord Michael wherever I go. I am his love protecting here, I am his love protecting here, I am his love protecting here. Archangel Michael sends his legions of blue lightning angels to protect you, as well as his own presence. So you have had the experience now of calling to an archangel for protection. You have exercised the throat chakra, the power center. You have exercised the power of the spoken word and used it constructively to invoke God's intercession in your life through the archangel of the first ray, Archangel Michael.
Thank you.
Gently, gently through the night, bands of listening angel tend the beds and cribs of children of all ages. And so we come, my legions and I, coming then with a listening ear to the hearts and minds and souls of children and of all people. And what do the children ask when they see beyond the realm of sleep the angels tending their beds? They say, O angels, listening angels, hear our prayer. We pray for father and mother, for their love to one another and to us. We pray for love, O listening angels, fill our house with love. We need love so much since we have left our home of light. O listening angels, whisper into the ears of Daddy and Mommy that love is all we need and all we want. We pray also that we might learn and learn what we must know and know what we have known before, but are soon forgetting, for we are now upon this lesser shore where the light does not shine so brightly, and we do not want to forget that realm of light from whence we have come. Oh, teach us to know, teach us to discern, teach us the basics of life and our lessons. Lessons from Sunday school. Lessons we are not hearing that our former angel teachers taught us. O listening angels, tell the heart of our Father, Mother, God, that we would fly on wisdom's ray each night, to go to the place where we can learn, for we are not learning here anymore what we need to know. O listening angels, teach us then the law of God. Teach us the way in which we must walk. Teach us, O listening angels, and send us by God's own hand, teachers who will show us what is that holy will, what is the true way back home, and why we are here, and what we are doing in this place, which is sometimes made so very, very dark by grown-ups when they, in some thoughtlessness, spread gloom and doom across the face of earth, or surround us with so much of this world and the things of this world, when we long, in fact, for our heavenly home. O listening angels, hear our prayers this night. We pray for children everywhere who have less than we do, and whose families and towns are burdened by war and loss of life. O listening angels, carry our prayers to God this night, that he might have mercy upon all his servants, and save poor sinners, and bring all home in the great convocation of light of our true Lord and Savior, the cosmic Christ, Jesus, our Lord, Gautama, our Lord, sons and daughters of God, our brothers and sisters. And so you who gather here in Atlanta now have heard the semblance of prayers of children everywhere who long for love, to be God taught and to know His will. Such simple longings of children. Some who have no food pray for food, but their souls know enough to also pray for spiritual nourishment. Some who have nothing yet pray for nothing except to help others. The hearts of children, as their hearts speak through their souls, after they have left the body to sleep at night, are the most precious of prayers that we hear out of all the earth. Children pray for graces, not for toys. Children remember God, for they are yet small and still can peep through the veil beyond the octaves to their home of light. Children come with a desire to console their parents, fully aware that their parents are burdened by many cares and concerns of the world. Oh, what a blessing it is to nurture these fine sensitivities of children and their sense of being so close to God through angels. I am indeed your listening angel, and I have numberless bands of angels who are listening not only to the prayers, but to the many types of expressions of the people of Earth, their frustrations, their angers, their self-pity, their feeling of aloneness in a wide, wide world where there is no real depth and no longer the ability for intimacy in spiritual matters, in communion with God or with another heart. Many people on earth suffer, as you know, and they do not pray. Therefore, we must listen to the expressions of the soul that may not be articulated, for their pain is so great. Listening angels are there when people pass from life in agony, and when there is the joyous birth of children. Listening angels are there to comfort souls whose bodies are being aborted, whose missions are being aborted. Oh, we tend these souls with greatest care that they may not be scarred when they must enter once again, and perhaps another and another try before someone will receive them, instead of closing the door and snuffing out the breath of life. Earth then and her people are also dealing with more karma than they have dealt with in many centuries. If it were possible, and it is indeed possible that this is so, and therefore the weight that people feel in their bodies is a weight of anguish. Some have accommodated themselves and created accommodations with life, and therefore they consider themselves well-balanced, happy, having all that they want of creature comforts. Yet they have lost contact with their souls, many of these, and they do not experience
for they have cut off the faculty of the soul, and therefore do not know when the soul feels naked and without anything, when they consider themselves rich and increased with goods, and having no wants whatsoever. There are many who cut off not only their own soul, but their own divine spark, their own reason for being. And they cut off the angels and God also. And they are very, very sure that they are right in every position they take, social, economic, political. All of their views are, of course, right. Yes, beloved ones, so sure are so many who ought not to be sure at all, for they have not the real and living contact. So many facades, so many layers, and when you go through them all, do you really find someone who is real? Are you not all searching for reality? Are you not all seeking that which is real? Yes, it is true. All want to feel the tangibility of divine substance, of something, even be it a beautiful pink rose or a lily or any of the multitude of flowers. Do they not bridge the gap from here to there? Are they not some scent of heaven, some presence so rare? Who can fashion a flower but angel devas? And then, of course, the songs of the birds and of children, such as the voice of the young boy you just heard, who came into this world that you might hear the clear voice of an angel, such a young child singing with such majesty. You must know for certain, beloved, of the inner training of these little ones who bring such offerings of love and lay them upon the heart of God. How many lifetimes has that one, a single angel, sung as a voice of heaven heard on earth? How rare are the gifts of God, yet how plentiful, when you do not expect perfection in the human and can rejoice in the heart's offering, even if the offering itself is not perfect. Thus, by the quality of the heart, the wisdom of the heart, and the great love of the heart, does earth sustain a course, so many millions of loving hearts, and yet so many other millions of hearts that are bitter, gone sour, no longer an open door for the bird of happiness to fly in and out, no longer an open door for the light of the sun to pass through. The mighty charity, Archia of Chamuel, does enter this room now with her legions of light. We are all serving on the third ray of divine love and the Holy Spirit and of compassion. Surely this is an hour when you can become the comforter fully, when you can pray to us that we might send your prayers to the heart of the Spirit of the living God, that you might give comfort to life